interest rates and why you're doing it. So instead of me just talking for a lot of the time, you're all going to have to be sorry to say I've got to say it. So why does anybody have any idea what the HCR of the interest rate is? Anybody at all, no? Why are you all here then? What's the point? Is it because you don't want to come in? Is it because you're really up for the user experience? You want to know what people are happy to think? You want to mess with your friends? You want to know more from psychology? Some difficult things, good. Any more? I start picking on people. I'm not having a little ball here, I'm throwing it to the audience. So, yes. Yes. Curiosity. Good, you're going to make your decision. I think whether this is a good option, you don't have a job. Okay, so I'm happy you're there. So the wrong answer would be because there's no coding, the wrong answer would be because there's no maths, because there is no coding, because there's lots of stats. Some of these are right.
Somebody coming in. It is always nice to see you, says the man behind the counter to the woman who has come in. She is shaking her umbrella, and I look the other way as they are kissing their hellos, and I'm pretending not to see them, and instead I pour the milk. I open up the paper. There's a story of an actor who had died while he was drinking. It was no one I had heard of. And I'm turning to the horoscope and looking for the funnies when I'm feeling someone watching me. And so I raise my head. There's a woman on the outside looking inside. Does she see me? No, she does not really see me, cause she sees her own reflection. And I'm trying not to notice that she's hitching up her skirt, and while she's straightening her stockings, her hair has gotten wet. Oh, this rain, it will continue through the morning as I'm listening to the bells of the cathedral. I am thinking of your voice and of the midnight picnic once upon a time before the rain began. When I finish up my coffee and it's time to catch the train.
That was a track by Suzanne Vega, and it's called Tom's Diner. How many people have heard that before? Okay, a few people have heard it before, cool. You're obviously extra cool dudes. The rest of the viewers was not coming to if you've not heard that. So, you might say, why the hell are you playing this in the new and experienced computer science technical third year lecture you've seen now? What's the significance of Tom's Diner in everyday life? Anybody got any clues? I don't necessarily expect you to know this right now, but we're going to. Any ideas? Your everyday life. So yeah? No? No? Just your everyday life? It's not a bad, answer, that's true, on the information you've got. Yes? Oh, you first, Andy.
We just use it as a metaphor to describe the experience we have for the things we interact with everyday things.
No? That's awesome, very good. I'm liking this original thought. In your exam, there's going to be 30%, 40% for original thought. You can't get a first without original thought. That's the kind of original thought we want. Okay? Yes?
I'm being observant, but more imagined.
That's also a good point, but it's far more technical than that. Okay, let me go a bit further. Most times I did significant user experience, not just your experience, user experience. Why the hell am I telling you about it? Skip that ahead. What properties of Tom's Diner makes it so significant? And Why does the significance of Tom's Diner represent good science? Who wants to tell me what science is? Because this course is only about science, it's all about science. Who wants to tell me what science is? Okay, well, we're going to find out. Okay, you'll notice that on most of these slides, and on the rest of the figures, there's this. Okay? The page number relates directly to these notes that you've got in front of you. So when you look at page 25, if the latex is generated correctly, you'll see, or you should see, something to do with Tom's Diner. So therefore, in your notes, page 25, you've got the questions. Next week, we're going to have a pop quiz where I'll be picking on you and you're going to be giving the answers to these questions at the start. At the start of each lecture, we'll be having a pop quiz. Okay? Now, next lecture is slightly different than normal because next lecture we've got Penny Allen, who's a user experience research and development scientist for the BBC, who's going to come in and give us a 1 hour lecture at 1 o'clock. Okay? 5 lectures time, you'll notice in the notes, in the syllabus, there's some stuff on aesthetics and emotion. We're going to go on a tour of the Manchester City Art Gallery in two groups. They've laid on some special stuff for us so we can actually experience some of this artistic, aesthetic, emotional stuff as opposed to me just talking about it. Okay? Of course, then we're going to do some hardcore stats just to ease it a bit. So, logistics. This particular lecture, I just want you all to understand what I'm going to expect from you and what you should be expecting from me, so that it's your third year option. You can decide whether this course is right for you or not. Okay? It might be after this first hour you decide, I don't want to do UX anymore, I want to do something else, and that's good. Okay? Or you might want to actually stay here with it. So I just want to give you an overview of how the course is going to work, how it's all set up, how it's going to be run. Okay? So, 21 teaching sessions split into 2 hour chunks from 11 till 1. It's pretty obvious in the second semester. 4 discussion topics. Now, these discussion topics are going to represent your coursework, and they represent 30% of the total mark. So you can go into your exam with 30%. Okay? It's not weighted, it's weighted 1 to 1, so there's no issue with that. It's not as though we're trying to get rid of it. You'll get 30% if you get top marks. Okay? You're all adults. If you don't want to be here, if you decide that you can do this UX stuff and you don't need to worry about it and still do the exam, you don't need to be. Okay? If you think you can get, I don't think you'll get the learning experience, and there's a direct correlation between the people who do turn up and the people who get over 56% in the exam. But if you're happy with 56% and you're reasonably good, you might have better things to do. Okay? I don't know. But you're all adults. So, what's the syllabus going to be? What am I going to actually teach you? Well, we've got this first thing. What should you expect? The second thing we're going to look at, and this will be after the coffee break, is everything is wrong. Okay. Now, this is a quote from a very famous scientist, a computer scientist actually, and this wrongness is at the heart of UX. You're looking for things that are wrong, not things that are right, things that are wrong, so you can correct them. It's not about patting yourself on the back and saying, that's great. It's about saying, we need to fix this, okay, because it's not working right. So you've got to look for things that are wrong. And that means not taking the conventional view. Okay? It also means not taking the common understanding oftentimes, okay? Because common understandings often don't work. Okay, UX at the moment is still nascent. It's very, very young. And it's really a smush together of objective stuff like usability and accessibility. And don't worry if you don't know these terms because they've come on obviously. It's a smush together of usability and accessibility, these things that are that have objective measures. And other things like emotion, aesthetics, which also play a part in the user experience, a thing called phonology, gamification. These things smush together to make a field, okay, that looks at the entire user experience, not just the sort of standard user experience that you might get from the normal HCI methodology. Okay. Building on the umbrella, we're going to touch on this. I want you to read the notes. This is all about development, it's about agile. I mean, most of you have done agile or know about agile, right? Yeah? Okay, so that's all. That's about agile and cowboy coding. Have you heard of cowboy coding? No? Well, it pretty much says what it is. And we'll get on to that. And then we'll look at this thing called It's Complicated. So this is all about humans. It's about the human visual system. It's about the human auditory system. It's about cognition. It's about how we understand memory and learning. It's about how we navigate. Okay. And it's also about the kinds of tools and inputs that we actually are able to use productively. Haptics are also featured in physicality and mobility there. What people want. So there's two here. What people hat racks for understanding, which is a quote by Mark Rittig, and what people want and don't use a napkin. So these three things are all about what you might want to know in software engineering, which is requirements engineering. Okay? But it's about participatory design, it's about the different design methodologies that come often from other fields such as anthropology, ethnography, social science, sociology. Okay? These kind of other fields such as participant observation that you will be using, you may use, in your formative, what we call formative evaluations. The evaluations, the requirements analysis that allow you to form your view or opinion of what the requirements are. Okay. Effective use. Well, you'll see effective use is really accessibility. But I'm calling it effective use because I think it's a better descriptor. Okay. Efficient use, that's more about usability, and I'm calling it efficient because I think it's a better descriptor as well. Emotional use. Now, emotional use is all about aesthetics and emotion and how there's this intangibility of personality that comes with different kinds of developments, which it's very difficult for us to measure or quantify. It's all got to be done in a qualitative way, so it's very difficult for us to say, this is exactly the case for all users. Well, that's both the hindrance and the great benefits of doing user experience kind of work. We'll then be looking at dynamic use. Now, dynamic use is all about communicating with others that we know that people do better jobs if they're actually in a team. That's why we've got pair programming. Okay, got pair coding just because people do better in teams in pairs. So this kind of way of trying to build into your software ways for people to collaborate, even in work situations, because they do a better job if they do. We're also looking at these other two things. Funology, how to add fun, aspects of fun, to your development, because people enjoy fun, and if it's a really tedious work day, and something on the computer system allows you to have a bit of fun while you're actually doing your work, that's a positive benefit, because it gives you, well, it makes you work more, actually. So. And then we've got another thing, which is called gamification. Gamification is super new, it's the big, this is great kind of thing, but it's still in its infancy. So we're going to have to look at gamification because you need to know that. Now, the point about this is that dynamic use I used to call digital umami. So it's digital deliciousness, if you like. It's kind of intangible and it's slightly a little bit derogatory. Okay, this is my interpretation of it. But it's for you to decide whether you think it's a good thing to have it in your systems or whether it's just some kind of fluff on the top. Okay? And then we're going to say, well, okay, don't panic. This is statistical analysis. Everything we do is in a qualitative way has statistics in it. So we're just going to look. I'm going to give you the basic. Who knows anything about stats? Bit stats. Good. That's good. We've got a little bit of stats. Well, we're going to do very simple stats. The underpinnings of the stats, what things actually mean, so how we interpret research papers. Okay, how it all fits together. We're going to talk about descriptive statistics, and then we're going to just look at a bit of inferential statistics where it gets a bit more tricky. Okay, but you're not going to have, 2 hours, I could do, an entire, complete programs just on statistical analysis. Okay, so we're not going to be doing it in that much depth, but I'll be giving you the tools you need to know to go into a company and be able to understand what the hell statisticians are telling you about the point. Yeah? Okay, and then IRL. So IRL in real life, it's all right me talking about this in this lecture theatre, but we work with lots of companies in our lab, and it's not like that in real life. There's too many constraints. So this is there for you to know that there are constraints you'll be placed under when you're working in these kind of situations, and it's okay that you're under those constraints, because everybody is. Okay? You just have to pick the best methodology and the best plan of action for this particular development. Okay, so the view from 30,000 feet. The reason why it's from 30,000 feet is because there is no way I can tell you everything there is to know about the UX. Okay? Don't confuse this high-level overview with the program. It's not. It's not meant to be, either. Okay? You know, there's aspects here where they've written, where the, say, for instance, ethnography. There's hundreds, if not thousands, of books just written on ethnography. A whole program to tell you how to do ethnography. Participant observation, stuff to do with things with people called key informants, that kind of thing. You're just going to get a microcosm of that. Okay? Tools and techniques and the mindset necessary to completely approach your first user testing and user experience job. Your third years, your software engineers, you're going to be going out into a software engineer, probably software engineering roles or certainly large corporation roles. I want you to be able to go to, this course is to prepare you to go into a user experience lab and do user experience, or at least be a junior member of that lab, understanding how other people are doing the user experience. There's a lot more in this course notes than you probably need for this course. But they're there because I expect you next year, when you're out in industry, to go back and look at some of the terminology. You'll get a comprehensive index at the end of this. So you're going to look at the terminology. So if people are telling you things, or they're talking to you about terms or subjects that you don't quite understand, you can look in the index and sort of get an idea of what further reading you should do, if nothing else. What are the key books in that particular area to read? You'll also notice, and I also don't expect you to do it directly, is that at the end of each chapter of this book, there's about 5 to 6 different books that you might want to read, okay, to brush up on. I do not expect you to read them for the course. Okay? What I do expect, though, is that you might want to look at those books and read those books in other situations when you're out there in industry. Okay? If you're a software engineer and you've got a user experience person talking to you, there needs to be some kind of translation between the two, because often there isn't. And so this book, or this text, should be there for you to do that. Okay? That's what it's about. Basis for further self-study. So there's further reading in this book, as I just said, but there's also a number of self-assessment questions at the end of each chapter. So these self-assessment questions will form part of the pop quizzes that we do, but when we don't cover them, you should also look, you should also try and do them yourself. You'll get the answers at the very end of the course, or near the end of the course, so you've got enough time to do the revision. Okay? Okay, so origins. There are plenty of definitions of user experience, and that's what we're going to look at in the first week, in next week. But think of it for now as the practical application of research knowledge, repurposed for different domains, anthropology, sociology, graphic design, industrial design, okay, and computer science. All smushed up into one thing. Okay? It's a real cross-disciplinary bag. It's still very young, but it does bring together intangible aspects of the field. You can also see it's better to understand our view here at Manchester's than other people's view. So because it's our research domain and it's other people's research domain, we have our view of what user experience really is, because it's not in any way fixed. Yeah? It's not like compiler design, where it's already there, it's an old subject, it's an old field, and you can actually, and everybody agrees in the domain of what everything is. They don't agree. Okay? They don't agree what are the best methods to use, they don't agree what UX actually means directly, and they certainly don't agree how best to develop and evaluate this stuff. Yeah? Okay, notes from scratch, there's no set text. Well, there is a set text, but there'll be more on this later. Coursework submissions, it's 250 words to Blackboard, okay? The first coursework, scarily, is due next week. I want you to be able to do as much of this coursework as is humanly possible early on, because all the other courses are going to be piling on coursework but near to the exams. So the deadlines, my deadlines, stretch over the whole period, but the point of these is that you can actually read what I'm going to give you. That's the learning experience, and then do the coursework from that learning experience. So you can do that right now. You could do all 4 this week if you wanted to. Yeah? And get them out of the way for 30%. But that's not, but the deadlines spread out through the year. You'll get our contract here is you're going to get your feedback and you're going to get your grades within 2 weeks, okay, of actually having it. So you'll get feedback. If you're not happy with the feedback or you want more, you want to know more, you just need to speak to me in a lecture. Or in one of the open house surgeries that I'm running. See discussion topics on page 27 in your notes. Step-by-step submission instructions are on appendix A, page 319, which is this appendix that I've just given you. Okay, I'll just think about. Okay, coursework submissions. Anybody, you might have seen this same slide in the databases course, because I used to do the databases course a long time ago. And this is, I'm hardcore when it comes to coursework and hard work and all this kind of stuff. So, no exceptions, no exemptions. Okay? No E will go into Arcade. You deliver it on time or it doesn't get delivered, and it doesn't get marked, and you don't get it. Okay? The printer will not be busy. You do not have to print it. It's not an excuse. If the power goes off, the computer explodes in your house, your computer scientists, back up. Do it now, okay? It's not an excuse. Here's one of that. Your hamster will not die in a sea-choking, horrible sea-choking accident, which has stopped you from actually completing your work, okay? It will not happen. It's not an excuse. You don't have a dog. It has not eaten your work, paper, USB stick, or anything else. This was a great excuse. Your USB pen has not been abducted by aliens. Okay? These are all excuses I've been given. I'm not just making them up. Okay. But if you get hit by a bus, suffer a gruesome chainsaw accident, get attacked by a loose buffalo, just so happens, along Oxford Road. I might be lenient, but I'll need to see the appendage that's been chopped off. Okay? Alright. Coursework submissions, page 22. We all understand each other. There's the deadlines. You complete it by the deadlines, we mark it and give it you back in 2 weeks. No exceptions, no excuses, no exemptions. Yeah? Plagiarism. It's all going through eternity. So do not plagiarise. Okay? You know, we all know, we're all super hot on plagiarism. And to be honest with you, we don't get very much of it here in computer science. And I wouldn't expect you guys as Spurgies to need to do it. But it's just something I need to say. Okay? You guys have got here. You're not going to be plagiarising stuff. I would expect. But please don't do it. Okay? Especially in a course like this where it's completely out of left field, where the actual work itself probably isn't in your comfort zone. It's not computer science. I mean, it is computer science, but it's not directly computer science that you've been used to. Okay? Okay, so let's have a quick look at the few discussion topics, which are research papers that you're going to see tomorrow. That you're going to be doing, that you're going to have a look at. Okay, so the first thing, understanding, scoping, and defining user experience. Okay, and this is by Effie Moore and her colleagues. Vicky Rotto's at Nokia. Okay, so these guys did a survey of people at the biggest human computer interaction conference called CAI, which has a 3,000 person attendance. And they wanted to know what is user experience, because as I've said, it's a novel field, it's very new. What is it? What do people think it is? How do they understand it? How does it all fit together? I want you to read this paper. It's 8 pages long. And then I want you to summarise it, tell me what are the key points, and tell me how it has affected your thought. What do you now think UX is? In 250 words. That's a bigger job than it sounds. Getting it into 250 words is a way bigger job than it sounds. There'll be a 10% margin, I'd imagine. So, a maximum of 275. Okay? This needs to be done for next week. And next week, we're going to then have a discussion about this, as well as doing all the marking and you getting your feedback. We'll be having a discussion about this. Okay? So you need to get some original thought into that. How it's actually going to all fit together is in your appendices. Okay, now, the second one is this, designing the star user interface. Does anybody know what the star computer is? Anybody ever heard of the star computer? No? Well, you should do. It's inconceivable to me that you've never been told about the star. So the star computer is the thing that created everything, the thing that created the GUI, for instance. Okay? It was created by Xerox PARC. Back in the day, right, 1978, they made about 1,000 prototypes, okay, to get it right. To understand the design and how this works, how it worked, how the user interface was put together and why, and why, for instance, scroll bars today are incorrect for usability, but on the iPad they're not. You need to read this paper. It's just inconceivable that you don't know this work. Okay, so this is coursework 2, and that will be due in 5 weeks or 4 weeks, something like this. It's down the line. It's a small, it's a shorter paper to read. It's up from Byte, so it's in common language, and it's only so this one's worth five marks. The next one. Anybody heard of Donald A. Norman? Nelson Norman Group. Donald Norman. Okay, good. So he's the big usability guy. Okay, he's worked in psychology actually, but he now does a lot of stuff in the HCI usability of artifacts. So this book, Emotion Design: Why We Love or Hate Everyday Things, is very useful for the emotional part of our course. Okay, because it's got quite a lot of intangibilities. I don't expect you to read 250 pages of the book. You'll see that there's a URL here, which is an abstracted version of it. It's just an HTML website. It's just an HTML page. It's very short. What I want you to do is read the HTML page and have a look at any of the little bits that get you excited and do the same for the 250 words. Okay? And that'll be in 8 weeks. Finally, VoiceLix is cooperative aid in space shuttle mission control. So this is a research paper 2. It's a very interesting research paper. We sometimes have this tendency to think that user experience is just about common garden applications sticking around, sitting about, okay? But it's not just about that. It's about safety critical systems. It's about safety critical failures, systems that can fail. And if they do fail and you do not get situational awareness, you do not understand what's going on, it's likely to have monumental problems. Okay, some of those problems we saw in various nuclear power plant designs where the two buttons which were placed next to each other were, one was to scramble the reactor and the other one was to do something completely not. So generally there's been instances where there's been catastrophic failures because the user experience, the interface itself, be that physical or virtual in software, hasn't been created correctly. Okay. You'll see there's some pictures that you can see of various nuclear power plants where they have various beer pools on the different knobs, because that's the only way they can differentiate them from each other. Okay, so that's not a very good design of user experience. So that's what you need to think about. It's not just sort of little apps for iPads. It's large systems for space shuttles, nuclear powered reactors, submarines, that kind of thing. Okay. We're also going to look in the next section of this course at some real life contracts. We've got the permission of these customers of ours to actually give you access to their reports, or to the reports that we've actually accessed for you. Okay. So generally the main one we're going to do is with the National Museum of Liverpool. We've done some work with them on making things, making their website more ergonomic, more usable. And so we're going to go through that in the real life section so you can understand what an actual usability report or a user experience report might actually contain, the kinds of stuff that might be in there. Okay, so this is a bit weird, you might imagine. So, the course text, apart from these notes, is this book. Anybody read it? Anybody read Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance? Oh, my lord! Come on, work with me here! Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, it's like a classic. It's not even like a classic, it is a classic. Okay. This is just a So this is what the American Library of Congress say. It's a claim. It's a modern classic. You guys should be reading this stuff. Anyway, why is it useful to the user experience? Well, it's useful to our discussion of the user experience for a heap of reasons. First of all, it talks about how traditional science and traditional classicism, traditional romanticism can come together, or the tensions that are there. It's not about Zen, and it's also not really about motorcycle maintenance. Okay? It's about quality, quality of the user experience, the values that you might put into that user experience, and the values that are self-evident, that are subjective, but observable in some way. Okay? It's about the scientific method, and why the scientific method has some problems with it, and why the scientific method should still be the thing that we're actually basing most of our work on. So Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance is a key text, in my opinion, for this kind of work. It's also, there's also two other reasons. One of them is that we know from cognitive science that you remember stuff better in the narrative. So if you're reading a narrative that's exciting, say, you're going to remember aspects of that narrative better than just, say, course text. So the idea here is that we're linking up this course text, these two bits of course text together, so that in reading Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, you'll start to relate this back to your course text and understand and remember this better. Okay? The next thing, the other reason why we're doing it, is because it provides lots of fodder for original thought. Okay? So therefore, what's in the course text notes might not be mirrored directly here, but certainly the principles and the concepts are, and you should be able to make a link between those and show that you've had some original thought, both for this text and in everyday life. Okay? Okay. So, assessment structure. Just so you know how it's going to be. 30%, as I already said, 70% of the final exam. Examination will be 2.25 hours long. It will be in two parts. The first part will be multiple choice questions, which are compulsory. You will do them. Okay. The second one is longer questions. Second part is longer questions, and you'll choose one question from two. Okay. Topics will be drawn randomly across the course. So therefore, don't just revise usability and accessibility and think, oh, there's bound to be something on that. Because there'll be bits spread everywhere. Okay, so there'll be a bit of usability, a bit of accessibility, a bit of all of the other topics. I want you to have an overview, a general broad education in this kind of stuff. Okay? You just need to know it. Now, to give you a quick taster, and I don't expect you to know the answers to these questions. Yes?
What's the weighting of the MCQs?
Okay, that's worth one question, so it'll be half. So there's 20 marks for all of the MCQs, 2 marks each, 20 marks for the entire, for the other one. Okay, for the entire sort of longer question. Okay. Now if it turns out this year that, I mean, this is how we used to do the stuff on the databases course. If it turns out that I don't think this is given a very good, representation of your abilities, then I'll look to speak about that in the exam meeting, school exam meeting. Okay, the kind of questions you can expect to get, they're not going to be silly little questions for the multiple choice questions. I don't expect to know the answers, but I do expect that you might want to, you know, these are all in your notes anyway. You might want to sort of think about this when you're actually taking notes for the lecture course itself. So, this is a scenario, and I'd expect you to choose the correct statistical test for that scenario from the list. Okay. This is the kind of MCQ test we're looking at. So it's not just book work. In the actual main, sort of, in the second part, if you like, where you've got a choice of one from two, we do different types of questions. So the first one is book work type question. What do we mean by internal and external validity? What's the scientific method? Why is it important? So this is just stuff you should just know. Okay, it's just like trot out these kind of definitions because you sometimes need to know just the definitions. Yeah. So this is the kind of underpinning knowledge. Discussion type question: how does UX relate to standard software engineering requirements analysis? And if there are no 100% correct answers in UX, how do you decide what's right and what's wrong? So these are going to be questions where I'm expecting a paragraph, maybe two paragraphs, half a page, that kind of thing. Yeah? Of discussion. Maybe diagrams will be required. Yeah? Application of technique. So here we've got a web page, list the 6 user experience errors in that web page, and tell me why. Or you've been tasked with proving that your company software is immediately learnable. design experiments. Discuss any issues, describe aim and analyse results. So for the first ones we talked about, this book work, you're going to get 2 marks each. So each one of those will be worth 2 marks. One of these might be worth 4 marks. One of these might be worth 6 marks. Okay? Original thought. What is quality? Define and discuss. Okay? And explain why you have come to this view and how it relates to user experience. The second one here is very real work. This thing here, there's been some work done on this particular question. On 49 medical articles, they weren't all correct. Is this a problem and why? Are we all going to die, generally, when you go to hospital? Okay? So you need to have some original thought for all of this stuff. Okay. Expectations and help. My primary expectation is that you'll all talk together. We'll all interact. It's been quite not interactive this first lecture because that's just the way it goes. Anybody interested will be able to understand this course, and only by understanding it will you be able to pass your exams. Not by just revising it and bookwork and all that kind of stuff. You might get 40. But you need to understand what's being said. So if you don't understand, you need to speak, you need to talk to me. I don't expect in these lectures for people to be reading papers or anything else that you wouldn't go with this kind of lecture. Okay, so taking notes is good, reading papers not good. Asking questions is good. Typing to your friends on text about last night's beer debacle, not good. Okay, if you want to do any of those things, any of the bad things, there's a cafe down there. Go over there. I'm here to help. If you've got problems with this course, you speak to me. If you've got problems, if the work you've got that you are expected to do is a problem, you speak to me. Problems in general that's not about this course, speak to me. A need for more feedback, whether from this course or questions posed in the course lectures or other lectures, speak to me. Anything else that you're not clear on, speak to me. Okay? And I will make sure that the feedback and the right people are connected to you. Okay, regardless. I'm not just here for UX, I'm here for everything. So now, it might be that you think, Simon, you're just absolutely crap at this lecturing thing. You just don't know what you're doing. This course is a pile of terribleness. What's going on? If that's the case, do not sit there. Speak to your third year tutor. Speak to your supervisor. Speak to the director of undergraduate studies. There will be no excuses on this course. I don't want course assessment questionnaire saying, oh, well, I wish I could have said something, but I didn't do it, but I don't think it could. If you're not happy with the experience you're having, Jesus, it's a user experience course, and you're the users, then,